Hello everyone, welcome to homeschool, and today we are starting with one more new chapter, that is carbon and its compound. And this is a very much essential chapter, very fundamental chapter to understand a branch of chemistry called organic chemistry. Okay, this is a fundamental aspect to study in detail about organic chemistry. So before we go for the chapter, let us understand the word called this organic chemistry. Guys, you all know our science is divided into physics, chemistry and biology. Yes or no? So some of your chapters are taught by chemistry experts and some of your chapters are taught by bio experts and few by physics experts, isn't it? In a similar way, our chemistry is also divided into three branches. First one is physical chemistry, inorganic chemistry and organic chemistry. There are many other branches for chemistry, but these three are the main branches: physical, inorganic and organic. So whatever chapters we studied under chemistry so far, we discussed about chemical reactions and equations, acids, bases and salts, metals, non-metals, isn't it? Then periodic table. And coming to this chapter, carbon and its compound. So all these five chapters, you know, some belong to the first category. Say this particular chapter belongs to this category and some will belong to physical category and some will belong to inorganic category. But that bifurcation is not there for your level. Okay, fine. And what do you mean by this organic chemistry? Organic chemistry is all about study of organic compounds. Study of organic compounds, guys. And the question is, what do you mean by organic compound? Say, the meaning of the word organic is nothing but life. Okay? The meaning of the word organic is nothing but life. Something natural, something which is having a life. Okay, so organic compounds are those compounds which are present in living organisms. Okay, and chemically speaking, organic compounds are those compounds which are made up of carbon and hydrogen mainly. This is important to understand. What do you mean by an organic compound now? It is that chemical compound which is made up of carbon and hydrogen mainly. These two elements are compulsorily should be present in a compound if you want to call it as organic. Okay, with these elements, other elements also can be present. Sometimes oxygen will be present, sometimes phosphorus you can observe, sometimes, you know, halogens you will observe, like fluorine, chlorine, bromine and all. Sometimes sulfur is observed and sometimes nitrogen is also observed. But these two elements are compulsorily should be present in a compound to be called as organic. Okay, so organic compounds are those compounds which mainly includes carbon and hydrogen. Carbon compulsory. Carbon is the main element. Carbon is the superhero in case of all organic compounds. Okay, without carbon, there is no organic compound in our nature. Okay, chemically we got to know what do you mean by organic compound, isn't it? And now, can you able to find out which are the organic compounds that you will see it in day-to-day life? See guys, the morning you open your eyes, can you all think of what chemical substances that you use? Okay, the moment you get up from your bed, bed in the sense, you know, bed sheet will be there, pillow will be there. All these are nothing but organic compounds. Yes, bed sheet. Lots of chemicals would be there in bed sheet. Pillow, lots of chemicals would be there. And each and every chemical which is there in bed sheet is nothing but organic compound. Carbon and hydrogen compulsorily is there in a bed sheet. Okay, and after that you brush your teeth. Bristles of the brush, organic compound. Okay, and the plastic items that you will use it, they are organic compounds. That means they are made up of carbon and hydrogen. And the food you eat, each and every food you eat, you take a vegetable, you take a fruit, you take chapati, rice, whatever, all pulses, all cereals, what not. Each and every food item is organic compound. They contain carbon and hydrogen in them compulsorily. And to be frank, we ourselves are organic compounds. Our skin is made up of carbon. Our hair is made up of carbon. From hair till the nail of your toe, everything is made up of carbon and hydrogen mainly. Even inside the body, each and every cell, each and every component or chemical that is present within the body, not only humans, all the living organisms, all animals and plants. Okay, in a living organism, each and every component and each and everything that is going on is with organic compound. See, that means in our nature, crores and crores of organic compounds are present. You can't even count. And the medicine that you take when you get sick is an organic compound. Yes, the tablets that you take when you get a fever or cough or whatever may be the disease, the syrups that you take, everything contains definitely an organic compounds. That means what I can tell you is, most of the chemicals that you see, that you touch, everything is organic in nature. That means it is the chemical which mainly contain carbon and hydrogen. Other elements sometimes will be present, no doubt. Along with these guys also can be present. But mainly carbon and hydrogen. You know, such compounds are organic compounds. And I already told you, crores and crores of organic compounds are there in our nature, naturally, and also artificially. Man is preparing organic compounds every day in lakhs. Isn't it? Right? So, study of such organic compounds is called organic chemistry. Okay, and to learn the concepts of organic chemistry in future, definitely this chapter is the basic that you need to understand. So in this chapter, what we are going to learn is all about the superhero, that is carbon. Okay, and about few aspects of organic compounds we are learning. Okay, so this is our motto of the chapter. We are learning entire thing. Why this guy is so much special? This is after all an element which is placed in the 14th group of your periodic table. Isn't it? What is the position of carbon? It comes in a 14th group. 14th group, first element is your carbon. Atomic number 6, mass number 12. This is after all an element which is there in our periodic table, but this element can lead to produce crores and crores of compounds. Isn't it? Why this element is so much special? Study of carbon and its compounds. I can say it's nothing but organic chemistry. See, study of one element is put up as a separate branch of chemistry. About nitrogen we don't study. About oxygen separately we don't study. About chlorine separately we don't study. Their compounds are very much limited in our nature. But the guy called carbon is so much special, and this carbon can produce lakhs and crores of compounds. So we are going to learn some basic aspects about this carbon, and we are going to learn some basic aspects that you must compulsorily understand to learn organic chemistry in future. Okay, and the chapter is very much interesting, and I tell you, I assure you, after listening to these videos on organic chemistry, you will never ever feel difficult with the chapter, even in the future. Okay, so when you go for 11th and 12th standard, most of the chemistry chapters belong to this category where children feel very difficult with organic chemistry. Okay, but if you have basics of organic chemistry, you will have fun in learning the concepts. Okay, and never ever by heart the concepts that come in organic chemistry. You just have to understand the logic behind it, and after that the story is over. You can work with the questions within a fraction of seconds. Okay, quickly let us go for the basics. Whatever is there in your syllabus. First and foremost, we are going to learn about our superhero carbon. Okay, let us learn why this carbon is so much special, why it can give crores and crores of compounds which are so much beneficial for the mankind. Okay, fine. And we all know atomic number of carbon. Let us just refresh some basics about the carbon. Atomic number. What is the atomic number of carbon? It is 6. Right, and mass number, what is the atomic mass of carbon? It is 12. Okay, and can you all able to write the electronic configuration of carbon here? Understanding electronic configuration is very important, guys. You must able to write electronic configuration for every element in a periodic table. I taught you a trick also, isn't it? So, what is the electronic configuration of carbon here? 1s2, 2s2 and 2p2, isn't it? And can you, which is the outermost shell? That means a last shell here, this one. Second shell is the last shell. Can you all tell me how many electrons are there in a last shell? Definitely, there are 4 valence electrons, isn't it? How many valence electrons, guys? 4 valence electrons. In chemistry, we are all interested about valence electrons only, because it is these guys who will participate in a chemical reaction. Yes or no? So it is very important to understand the valence electrons of an element. There are 4 valence electrons. Okay, so keeping these basic aspects of carbon in our mind, let us go for the topic, why carbon is unique. Why carbon is unique. Why this particular guy can give you crores and crores of organic compounds in our nature. Or we can also say it as versatile nature of carbon. We are discussing versatile nature of carbon. What do you mean by the word versatile? The word versatile means unique. The word versatile in the sense unique. So why carbon is special? That is what we are going to learn. Mainly there are 2 reasons. There are so many reasons, but the special reasons are 2. Okay, which other elements do not have actually. So the 2 reasons here is, the first one is tetravalency nature. Tetravalency. Carbon has a property called tetravalency. And the second reason is, it will show a special property called catenation. very different and new word for you. It is catenation. And now let us discuss what do you mean by this tetravalency and catenation in detail. Okay, try to understand the meaning of the word tetravalency. What do you mean by tetra? Tetra in the sense four. Valency, you all know. But here, the valency means number of electrons present in the valence shell. I already gave you the electronic configuration of carbon, isn't it? What is its electronic configuration? 1s2, 2s2, 2p2. Valence shell, that means the last shell is second shell. In the second shell, you have 2 plus 2, 4 electrons. That means how many valence electrons are there in carbon? 4. That is the reason having 4 valence electrons is called tetravalency. So what do you mean by tetravalency? Having 4 valence electrons is called tetravalency. Okay. This is one of the special property of carbon. Do you think this seems to be special? What's so special? All 14 the group elements have 4 valence electrons, isn't it? Can you all able to think the 14th group elements? Carbon, silicon, yes or no? Carbon, silicon, tin, lead, all these guys have 14, you know, 4 valence electrons. 14th group elements, 4 valence electrons. So what is so special of carbon having 4 valence electron? Even silicon has 4 valence electron, tin has 4 valence electron, lead has 4 valence electrons, isn't it? So what is so special? The speciality is, you know, the size is not similar, isn't it? Periodic table chapter, I told you. The size always increases from top to bottom. That means bottommost elements are bigger in size and the topmost elements are smaller in size. Among the 14th group element, the smallest element is carbon, isn't it? So here you have a link with carbon. Link with the size of a carbon. Okay. Being the smallest element in a group and having 4 valence electron is the speciality here. Being smallest in a family and having 4 valence electron is the special property, and that is what we mean by tetravalency. Okay. And now, since it has 4 valence electrons, you know, it can share 4 valence electrons. It can share its 4 electrons with other elements to make bonds. Such a bond, we will call it as covalent bond. Okay? See, I'll explain you in detail. Just try to understand. Since it has 4 valence electrons, whatever I write on a board should be there in your book. Until and unless you practice this chapter with writing, it will not come. You should practice it. Okay? Since it has 4 valence electrons, this is a shortcut for electrons. Okay? Since it has 4 valence electrons, it can share them with other elements. With other elements. What are the other elements? The main element is hydrogen. Okay. With other element to form covalent bond. To form covalent bonds. Okay. So what do you mean by this covalent bond? You heard of ionic bond, isn't it? What was ionic bond? The bond that is formed between positive guy and negative guy. You have seen the formation of NaCl, isn't it? How this NaCl has formed actually? The guy sodium lost an electron and that electron was taken by chlorine, isn't it? After losing an electron, your sodium became Na plus, and after gaining one electron, your Cl became Cl minus. Both of them combined and you got a compound NaCl. Okay, so here what you have observed here, transfer of electrons has been observed. If attraction is created between the two guys on transfer of electrons, then it is called ionic bond. Okay, but here carbon will never form ionic bonds. Okay, remember a point here, carbon cannot make ionic bonds. Okay, it is because it cannot lose electrons and it cannot gain electrons. Okay, when I explained you about the valency, I have very easily told you all these guys have a valency plus 4. Plus in the sense what? All these guys will lose 4 electrons, I told. But practically speaking, these guys will not lose 4 electrons. It's highly difficult. Losing 4 electrons is not a small issue. 1 electron they can lose easily, 2 electrons, 3 electrons also. But losing 4 electrons is very, very, very difficult. Okay, it is because why they cannot lose 4 electrons is because they are small in size. I already told you, 14th group elements, right? They are at the rightmost side. When you go from left to right, size decreases. See, we are using the concepts of periodic table here. That is the most basic aspect. Rightmost side, 14th group, 15th group, 16th, 17th groups will come. Okay, size is smallest. These guys are small in size. So what will happen is, say this is the nucleus of carbon. This is the first shell. This is the second shell. First shell has 2 electrons. Second shell has 4 electrons. Okay. So these are very small in size. When the size is very small, I told you during atomic size video, the attraction between the nucleus and the outermost shell will be maximum. Okay, the shell is very near to the nucleus. So in that case, nucleus will tightly hold these electrons. Okay, so they have very nice attraction towards nucleus. Nucleus is holding them. In that case, can they go out of the atom very easily? Losing electrons means what? These valence electrons should leave its shell, leave its place, and it should go out. That's what we mean by losing electrons. Yes or no? Losing electrons means what? These guys should go out. How they will go out? They have to leave this place and go out. Can they leave this place? Because there is a guy which is showing more attraction towards them. You know, they don't want to go out. They want to stay near. Isn't it? So losing 4 electrons is highly difficult because the size is very small. Since the size is very small, the guy nucleus is holding them very tightly because they are near to the nucleus. Okay, since the nucleus is holding them very tightly, they can't go out. You know, the atom cannot lose those electrons. Okay, say in order to, why actually anything should lose or gain electrons? In order to have noble gas electronic configuration. Yes or no? In order to have 8 electrons in their valence shell. Say this carbon, usually when does this carbon can be happy? Either it should lose these 4 electrons. If it loses these 4 electrons, our electronic configuration will be 1s2, which is equal to the electronic configuration of helium. Isn't it? But losing business cannot happen here. Yes or no? Losing though is very much impossible because the nucleus, the guys are very near to the nucleus and the nucleus is very nicely holding them, so they can't go out. Yes or no? Okay, this option is eliminated to get stability for carbon. Okay, one option is it should lose all these 4 electrons in order to have helium's electronic configuration. That option is not possible now because losing business cannot happen that easily. And try to go for any other option. Say, for example, if it can gain four electrons, what will happen? Imagine this guy is gaining four electrons. Then what is the electronic configuration you will observe? 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, isn't it? Then this is also a stable electronic configuration which is similar to neon. See, outermost shell has 8 electrons. Having 8 electrons in the last shell means it is having noble gas electronic configuration only. Okay, so in that case it becomes stable. It can become stable. Okay, this is another option. Losing, either it has to lose 4 electrons to have a electronic configuration similar to helium, or it should gain 4 electrons to have an electronic configuration similar to neon. Now I just taught you that it cannot lose electrons. Okay, now try to think of gaining electrons. Can it gain electrons? It cannot gain electrons also. 1 electron can be gained easily, 2 electrons, but taking 4 electrons is highly difficult. Okay, imagine if this guy has taken another more 4 electrons from other species. That means the nucleus should hold these guys also. But the nucleus, you know, the positive charges of the nucleus is very small. It cannot hold that many electrons. Okay, the nucleus will be very much stressed to hold the incoming 4 electrons also. So gaining 4 electrons is also difficult. That means our carbon cannot give electrons, cannot take electrons. If it is giving electrons, it should give 4 electrons to become stable. If it is gaining electrons, it should gain 4 electrons to become stable. But both cannot happen here. When it is not giving electron and taking electron, how can it make ionic bond? Ionic bond is all about giving and taking electron business, no? Okay, but this guy cannot lose electron and cannot take electrons also because of its size and because of its higher attraction between nucleus and the valence electrons. Okay, so what is the answer here? Carbon cannot make ionic bonds. Why, they will ask you in an exam. So what is the answer you will write here? Carbon cannot lose electrons, cannot lose electrons and cannot gain electrons. You know, if it has to lose the electrons, it should lose 4 electrons and it should become C+4, isn't it? If it has to gain 4 electrons, it should gain it and it should become C-4. But becoming C+4 and C-4 is a highly impossible task. Okay, these ions cannot be formed with carbon. Okay, when do you get the formation of C+4? When the carbon loses 4 electrons. When do you get the formation of C-4? When the carbon gains 4 electrons. Whereas losing and gaining business so cannot happen with this carbon. Yes or no? So these ions cannot be formed. When ion is not forming, then how can an ionic bond is formed? Ionic bond is all about the attraction between positive guy and negative guy, no? Yes or no? If it has to have an attraction with another element, either it should have a positive charge or it should have a negative charge, where it is highly impossible thing. Okay, so that is the reason. See, now you think of how it can become stable then. If it has to become stable, definitely the last shell should have 8 electrons. Yes or no? That is the main thing. Okay, then these things, losing, taking things, never happen with carbon. Then think of how it can become stable. It can become stable by sharing electrons. It can become stable by sharing electrons. Okay, remember, carbon can become stable by sharing electrons. Okay, with whom it will share electrons? it may share with hydrogen, it may share its electron with another carbon only. Okay, so it will become stable by sharing electrons. Then that sharing of electrons is called covalent bond. Okay, if a bond is formed by sharing of electron, then such a bond we will call it as covalent bond. Okay, fine. And about covalent bond, how an electrons are getting shared, everything we will discuss in the next video. Till then, keep revising this concept, and this is very, very important. Okay, so here try to remember what is tetravalency. Also remember, carbon forms covalent bonds. Why? Why? Because ionic bonds cannot be possible. Why ionic bonds are not possible with carbon? Reason. Okay, the reason is carbon cannot lose electrons to become C plus 4, and carbon cannot gain electrons to become C minus 4. So ionic bonds are not possible. Okay, and also why it cannot lose electron and why it cannot gain electron? It is because carbon is very, very small in size. Small in size as well as there is lots of attraction between this particular nucleus and the valence electrons. Okay, so these are the important concepts that you have to remember. So thank you so much. We will meet up in the next video. If you like our concept, please like it, share it, and subscribe our channel for more updates to learn it in an easier way.